All right, so very good evening. First of all, I must thank Chef Garima for having me here on the occasion of releasing the first chapter of Food Forward India. It's a pleasure to be here in this audience, which is of expert chefs, food connoisseurs, food writers, and related people. I'm an odd man out here. I'm Ganesh Bagler. I am from IIIT Delhi. I am part of Center for Computational Biology, and I have been developing this thought of computational gastronomy, I'm sure, which is going to be a tangential from what you typically do. So my job is to convey you the excitement of what I'm doing and to tell you how relevant it is going to be for the food in general and specifically for the Indian food. So I'm going to present you the way forward for the Indian cuisine via data. And data is the oil. Data is the future of food is what I'm going to present. So I'm going to present you the thought of artificial intelligence, which is a term that you must have heard in the newspapers, which tries to emulate human intelligence. My thought here is chefs are intelligent agents which have imbibed centuries-long history, tradition, culture, the culinary history, right? Can we extract this? Can we therefore learn from this and create an artificially intelligent agent which will help us cook better and eat better? That's what I'm going to present you in the next 15 minutes or so. If you thought that food and computers were always on my mind, you'll be completely wrong about it. I am trained as a physicist in a place which is not too far from here in Pune in physics department. And I did my master's thesis in astrophysics in IUCA, if you have heard about it, Inter-University Center for Astronomy and Astrophysics, which is famous by Jayant Nadikar's name in this part of the world, even across the world for that matter. Right? So starting from that journey into computer science, then computational biology, it's been a detour. I'm not a regular scientist. If you thought scientists are focused people, look at me. I'm not. So I keep changing my topics, looking at anything that excites me, arouses me, and work on them. So I have been an aspiring astronomer. And as a teenager, my aim, my dream was to look through the telescope and discover new stars. But over a long time, I have serendipitously ended up reaching to this topic of looking at food from a data-centric perspective. And in my lab, starting from the journey when I started this approximately 5 years back in IIT Jodhpur and today in IIIT Delhi, I have been developing algorithms and databases which are focusing on various jigsaw pieces of food puzzle. And those are the recipes, flavors, health, and the nutrition. All of these aspects we have been touching. It's been a patient game of putting together these jigsaw pieces without any, you know, major support from government or even private agencies for a long period of time, quite clearly because I could see the future, which is what I'm going to present to you now. What we have ended up developing is called as computational gastronomy. If you have heard about words like computational physics, computational chemistry, all of these refer to how the ancient sciences like physics and chemistry have been transformed thanks to the revolution in the computing or computer science. In a similar manner, the food or gastronomy, which has been there for a long, long time, and each one of you have been related to it in one way or the other way by virtue of understanding it, knowing the techniques, cooking it on a day-to-day basis, or by critiquing it, I'm trying to present to you that using computer science and data science, one can actually blend food data and computation for data-driven food innovations. So I'm making a big statement here, so let me go ahead and explain what this computational gastronomy is. And while I do so, let me present to you the story of India, which is at the center of why we are here, the Food Forward India chapter. India is rich and diverse in terms of cultures, and it has got a diverse culinary heritage which all of us agree upon. And that's why many of us have been saying that we can't catalog recipes, because there are, unlike Western cuisines, we don't have standardized recipes per se. We have variations. When you go to South India, you'll have variations of sambars and rasams. And if you come to Maharashtra, you would have variations of even pohas to an extent, right? To what extent you are going to document and call a poha? Right, there will be a fight over is this a poha or not, for example. Right. So these are characteristic features of Indian cuisine that I recently documented in an article, that of diversity, that of being historically rich and culture rich, that of having health-centric focus thanks to the the focus that is been given by Ayurveda and other medicinal systems, we look at food as something which can be used for meddling with, for changing our health for better. In fact, when we go to doctor, after taking medicine, we ask, is there anything that I should follow as a diet? That's something which is pretty common, if you're not, I think all of us are aware of that, right? And finally, we have had practices of using food in a sustainable manner, right? So we started this study of looking at Indian food from a data science perspective. How did we do that? Look, we had to investigate food and check what are the patterns in Indian recipes. The question that we're asking here is that, what is Indian cuisine? And what is it that makes it unique? Is there a quintessential pattern, if at all there is any, that makes Indian cuisine so unique? That's the question that we were asking. And there was an existing principle called the food pairing hypothesis, which you must have heard about thanks to Heston Blumenthal, which says that in a typical recipe, ingredients that are similar tend to go well with each other. That's a food pairing principle, right? So we wanted to investigate this principle in the context of Indian cuisine. So we started looking at Indian recipes. We looked at recipes from across the length and the breadth of the country, these eight different regional cuisines or cultural cuisines, if you wish, and further looked into the recipes and the ingredients that are going into it. So for us at this level, we treated recipe in a very simplistic manner. We said a recipe can be said as a bunch of ingredients. I know it's wrong. Each of the chef in you is kind of revolting right now. And chefs have told me that come next time to my kitchen, I'll give you an ordered list of ingredients. Of course, that's not going to be true, but be patient with me. So having started with this notion of recipes, which are nothing but combinations of ingredients, we went to the next level to check the Heston Blumenthal's hypothesis, which is, how do you check food pairing? So you need to look at the flavor molecules which are present in the ingredients. The reason being that the ingredients that have been chosen into the recipes have been chosen predominantly for their taste and odor, although, you know, the texture and color and other factors would also play a role, but predominantly it is through what are called as olfactory and gustatory, the taste mechanisms and the odor mechanisms, which play a big role in why an ingredient is being chosen into a given recipe, historically speaking, right? So we looked into the flavor molecules of those. Having got this data and noticed each of the ingredient was categorized into one of those categories, the additive, nuts, seed, flowers, fruit, herb, such 16 categories. Now, I hope you appreciate this is a considerable amount of work of documenting 2,543 recipes, which are made up of around 200 odd ingredients, which themselves are made up of or having around few thousands of flavor molecules, right? Quite a bit of job that is done here. Having done this, we said, okay, now let's measure the food pairing. When we measure the food pairing, the way it is done is like this. You take one of the recipes across all the recipes that is there in the cuisine, all right? And break down that recipe into its constituent ingredients. In this particular example I have taken a caricature example of coconut chutney. I know coconut chutney has large number of ingredients and not exactly these ones, I know that, but this is a caricature. Let's say it has got four ingredients. What do we do next? What we do is to make pairs of these ingredients because we would like to look at food pairing. So we have these six pairs. Now, basic statistics that you must have learned sometime before 10th, which is so-called NC2, right? Combinations, pairwise combinations. So there are six combinations that you can have for four ingredients. So for each pair, such as the one which is here, onion and coconut, the simple question that you ask, having got the data, is this. How many molecules are common between these two? And how can we answer it? Because we already got the data. We know how many molecules are there in onion and which are the ones which are present in coconut. And let's say the number comes out to be 5. And keep doing for the all other pairs, right? Well, you get a number. The beautiful thing that has happened here, as Kelvin said, is that nothing is science until you can measure it. Unfortunately, while we can appreciate the straight drive of Tendulkar or some shots of somebody, it can't be a science, it's art. Music, you know, A.R. Rahman will remain A.R. Rahman, he won't become A.I. Rahman, artificial intelligent Rahman, until you study the music from a data science perspective. This is not to humanize or kind of dehumanize or take the art and the aesthetics perspective, right? But this is also about learning from it. Had Newton not studied the falling apples and got the laws, we wouldn't have had the satellites and everything running around us. So there is a time when we need to look at it from a scientific perspective, and there is a time when somebody like Chef Garima gives us a recipe, you enjoy the recipe rather than trying to break it down into its flavor components, right? So that's what I'm trying to do in both ways. Having got this, you get a one number. So for example, it's let's say 4.93. That's the number which is an average number of flavor molecules across all pair of these ingredients. That's all I'm getting here, right? Having got this number, all of a sudden we have a perspective. What is that? The perspective is this. So what is the comparison that we are doing here with? The comparison is that of so-called monkey cuisine. What does that mean? Well, it's almost like this. Let's assume that we have a kitchen and we have a basket of vegetables, spices, lentils, dairy, etc., those categories of ingredient that I mentioned. If a monkey or somebody like me who untrained in cooking were to enter into kitchen and try to create recipes, one would do it randomly. Arbitrarily, you like to put together ingredients, let's say. If you were to do so, it would be nothing but tantamount to a monkey cuisine. That's what we say. But even in a monkey recipe, you will have some amount of sharing of the flavor molecules, quite clearly, because natural ingredients tend to have a lot of flavor overlap, right? So such a number would be our comparison. Compared to such a monkey or a randomized bunch of recipes that are created without any rules, without any role of geography, climate, culture, religion, or even for that matter, genetics to an extent, that has played a role in why the recipes that are here are different from what are there in Southeast Asia or in, let's say, Latin America, right? Turns out that we got an interesting observation that Western cuisines, as it was observed, mentioned in 2011 paper in Scientific Report, have a uniform blend of ingredients, similar type of ingredients going together, whereas in the Indian cuisine, what we found is that a typical recipe will tend to have a contrasting blend of ingredients, a potpourri of flavors in a single recipe. I hope most of the chefs would resonate with this thought, right? Well, that was an interesting observation, and it being an interesting observation got a lot of attention. And this observation of contrasting blend of ingredients in Indian cuisine was also highlighted as an MIT Technology Review Emerging Technology. One of the interesting things also we did is to find out which category of ingredients are so critical for the blend that we find in Indian recipes. So without getting into the technical nitty-gritties, I'll briefly summarize this and tell you, if you were to shuffle, everything else is remaining same, but only shuffle vegetable across each other, what would happen to the food pairing? Again, not talking about taste, but to the food pairing pattern, food pairing number, right? And what would happen if I were to keep everything else same, but shuffle all the dairy products across all recipes in a cuisine, is what I'm referring to, right? Well, when we did this experiment, we find that for no other ingredient category, when you do the shuffling or intra-category shuffling experiment, the food pairing index changes drastically. Only marginal changes happen. But for spices, there is a huge jump that happens in food pairing index that we measure, suggesting that there is something special about spices when it comes to the Indian cuisine. All right? So that's why we proclaim that spice is the taste of India. Right? This is a spoof on one of the popular Indian brands. So we said that, look, spices are actually the molecular fulcrum of Indian cuisine. Proper, correct placement of a spice in a given Indian recipe makes what it is, right? Therefore, and I guess chefs don't have to be retold this business. In fact, the beauty of science is this. Something which was intuitionally understood, apples fall, but they fall according to F equal to m1 into m2 by r square, was to be told by Newton, right? In a similar manner, that there is a pattern, that there is a certain kind of a rule that is followed by Indian cuisine is understood by us intuitionally, but to make it quantitative is what a scientist does. And that's what we and our science ended up doing it for you, okay? Well, importantly, this was a conjecture that I had, that why is it that we use spices in our recipes? I mean, is it only because of the flavor and fragrance, or is it because of the antimicrobial properties which has been propagated a lot from around 1998 onwards from a couple of papers? What we figured out in the follow-up studies that we did is that herbs and spices, apart from being antimicrobial properties, they also have a broad spectrum of benevolence against cardiovascular disorders, immune system disorders, gastrointestinal disorders, etc. And this is coming from, not from what I am saying, but from a large number of research articles published in something called PubMed, a standard repository of medical repository, right? So this is our published work where we showed this, suggesting that, look, the reason why not only Indian cuisine, but many other cuisines tend to use herbs and spices need not necessarily because of their only antimicrobial properties or preservative properties, but because of some perceived understanding of benevolence value against various disorders. Okay? All right. Having said that, I'll complete this pitch with Indian cuisine to tell you that such kind of studies, in my opinion, A, allow us to tell us what the cuisine is. In my opinion, you can't preserve a cuisine, you can't make it known across the world until you can tell what it is, identity, as I call it. Identity of a cuisine need to be understood, and beyond qualitative understanding of identity of a cuisine, probably quantitative understanding will give us a better way of, better handle of pushing up, you know, standing up and saying that this is what the Indian cuisine is all about. So similarly, even other cuisine could say also about what they are about, right, their identity. And probably this could help in tourism and even other arenas of life. I mean, had I not done this science, probably Chef Garima would not have called me. She just read my paper and called me, right? So such science is required to create an identity, in my opinion. What we have done is this, that going beyond only pairings, we said, why only look at pair of ingredients? Can't we look at three of them together, or quadrangles, four of them together, and higher level combinations, as we call them in computer science, right? What we did is that by doing so, we have created what is called as a culinary fingerprint. Okay, fingerprint is nothing but a pattern which uniquely identifies who you are, a DNA fingerprint, for example, right? In a similar manner, we have created a culinary fingerprint which will look at a cuisine, look at ingredients, look at flavor molecules and even other details, and try to come up with what makes this cuisine so unique about it. And in my opinion, this such kind of a culinary fingerprint is going to be rather essential for portraying India's importance, the Indian cuisine's importance, the importance of India's culinary heritage on a world stage, and to be able to put it forward in a very emphatic manner, to call it actually India food for, I mean, food forward India. All right, so this is what I was saying MIT Tech Review highlighting us as an emerging technology. For me, this was a shocker. This paper was yet to be published. In fact, it was on an archive, and that is when MIT Tech Review picked it up, reviewed it, and proclaimed it to be an emerging technology. This doesn't happen every day. So to an extent, we should also be proud that the science of culinary, the science of food has emerged and has been developed in the name of computational gastronomy pretty much within India, largely, and the world is taking it. And this is, I'm not saying this from a fake sense of patriotism. No, no, no. Science is beyond the boundaries of any country or any nation for that matter. But to an extent, we should be proud of what comes out of India as well, without having to be anti-patriotic in that way. The industry is also taking over, and it says that, look, Ganesh, computer science is changing various aspects of our life. You know, today when you use Uber and Ola, it's because of computer science. Data collected by Google Map, algorithms which are being run by Uber and Ola are making your life easy to find a cab faster and better and cheaper, right? In a similar manner, and there are other aspects of like weather prediction, which were otherwise unbelievable earlier, have become relatively believable in short term, right? All of these are happening by virtue of data being gathered, domain-specific data being gathered, and computation power being applied. Question is, can we do it for the same for food? Okay, that's what is under process right now. Now what I'll do is that, because I've done the major part of conveying you about the relevance of why we need to see data from food from a data science point of view, Indian cuisine from a data science point of view, to be able to make Food Forward India a legible, a worthwhile goal, and giving India and Indian culinary heritage its own unique place on the world's landscape. I'll take only 5 minutes and run you and through what we have done in the last 4 years, roughly speaking, after this 2015 study, to tell you the future of where we are going to in a quick manner. All right? We have used and are using the so-called artificial intelligence and machine learning for understanding food from a recipes point of view, and I'll tell you some of the exciting perspectives that are coming out of it. Secondly, at a molecular level, what are the things that we are doing, very briefly. And finally, the health part of it. Can we use it for dietary interventions is the question that we are asking in our lab. Two things, databases. As I told you that if there is no data, there is no artificial intelligence. Computer science can't help you in improving your whatever you are doing, for example, if there was no data. If there was no Google Map, forget about Ubers and Olas. Clear? Right? Because you need to know where the car is going before you can reach there. Similarly, when it comes to food, if you want to navigate the landscape of food, you need to understand the food and the correlates of food very well. What we have done, in summary, is that we have compiled recipes from across the world and have mapped, we call them annotated, in a detailed fashion. We have today 158,000 recipes from across the world, and they are from 26 countries, 24 six regions, and 74 countries. across the world, right? And they have been broken down into pieces of ingredient section, what are the different parts of ingredients, quantity, unit, etc., and the algorithms to extract this information at the back end, right? So that has been done. Further, we have published a flavor DB. I told you that flavor information is also required. So ingredients, natural ingredients which go into the recipes and their flavor information, we have gathered and created a repository of it and is being made available for non-commercial purposes. If somebody wants to use it for academic work, one may do that, explore it. The reason is this, is that we want this area to grow. We want people to come forward, use this data, analyze their recipes, whatever they want to do for non-commercial purposes, they could do that. By the way, this was published in a very prestigious journal called Nucleic Acid Research in Oxford University Press. All right, what we have done is to go beyond India and do the culinary fingerprinting of the world cuisines. If you want to show the uniqueness of India, we need to know how French cuisine is different from India. So a comparative analysis is necessary. So we have done that in the context of various world cuisines. And by the way, this paper won the best paper award in Paris in a very computer science magazine. All right. One of the most exciting things that we are dealing right now is that of, as you must have probably have seen this kind of a tree in the context of language, the Indo-Arabian languages, Dravidian languages, Germanic languages, right? Well, like languages, food is also a cultural artifact. It is intimately attached with the culture and civilization. Question here is this, similar to languages, can we find out how languages are similar or dissimilar to each other and to tell how far they are from each other? Quite clearly you can say that Tamil language is very close to Malayalam, but it is slightly away from that of Kannadiga, and Kannadiga is very different from that of other Devanagari languages, for example, Hindi, right? And Hindi is closer to Arabic languages. You can say all this by doing some systematic analysis and data-based analysis. In a similar manner, can we say the same thing about the cuisine? Well, that's what we are up to right now, and we believe we have got the first tree of the world culinary tree, and we have trees like cuisines like Japan, China, Korea, Thailand, Southeast Asia right now bundled in a single bunch because of the number of recipes are less, and similar kind of a picture, right? In my opinion, this is one of the most exciting thing that we are doing. Again, this will put forward if for example, India's uniqueness, how it is different from the rest of them in a clear-cut fashion on a scientific basis, okay? Well, the question that we are asking in our lab is this. I told you, AI Rahman, right? Artificially intelligent Rahman. It would be an insult to talk about creating music which is AR Rahman-ish with a computer, right? But people are doing it already. This is not to say that AR Rahman has been replicated, but this is to say that probably AR Rahman's signature has been replicated to an extent, right? What we are trying to do in our lab is by compiling some million recipes or so, can we learn from these recipes to create a recipe which is human-like? Okay, this is something called Turing test for chef, by the way, if you have known what is Turing test, right? So they're trying to cheat a chef in thinking a recipe created by a computer like as if it is coming from a chef or from a traditional recipe, right? It's a long shot. It will take a while. Don't worry, it's going to take a while. But nonetheless, we are asking this question, and this question is more inspired from the Ratatouille movie about anybody can cook. The motto is that. So can actually computers cook? My understanding is this, even 5 years down the line or so, probably computers won't be doing cooking. They would be helping a chef cook better, helping a chef come up with a better intuition of what to mix with what, as you said, right? Probably. And where is that confidence coming from? Because today, there are artificial intelligence, by the way, please look up artificial intelligence and what it is doing to us in the last 15 years. Artificial intelligence is all over us. Whether it is tagging your photograph on Facebook or logging into your MacBook is there. Right, so it is all happening because of artificial intelligence. Computers have learned to understand your face. Am I right about it? Your mobile knows your face. How does it know it? Whether or without or with or makeup or with or without glasses, it knows that fairly well. It doesn't make mistakes. That's because of artificial intelligence, and the same thing can revolutionize the chef space is what I'm trying to tell. We are trying to do something in the context of dietary interventions. I'm not going to go into details of it, but in summary, we're trying to come up with this notion of how human body interacts with food, giving rise to health impacts. We have created databases called SpiceRx and DietRx, which give you scientific data of 90 years and 38,000 papers pulled together of 2,200 odd natural ingredients used in recipes. That's quite a lot of data. And we can ask this question, can I design a recipe better for diabetes? Can I design a recipe better for cardiovascular disorders based on empirical data? not based on intuition or some such heuristic, based on empirical data. Can we do that? So we are moving into that direction, and in our lab we are doing multiple things just to give a summary of what data can help us doing. I didn't never believe this. In 2015, had you told me that Ganesh would be doing this 4 years down the line, I would have never believed. I was happily working on brains, airport networks, in silico drug discovery, and all such exciting topics, right? So food has been, the reason I'm standing here in Solo House and talking to you guys, an allied audience in food, is because of some, you know, idiosyncratic journey and a serendipitous journey that I took, right? My last pitch is this. To be able to preserve, you need to start with documentation. A lot has been said, more than you've said. So we'll wait and watch for the discussions to come up. We need to analyze it. This is two things that probably one would not think about, which is what I'm pitching for. That we need to understand, analyze it better and understand it to before we can say we can preserve it. In my opinion, that's a more subtle and very systematic way of going towards preservation. And in my opinion, we must do that. And a movement like Food for India, in my opinion, is pretty much relevant and is necessary, whether you think in a patriotic manner, or you want to think it from a culinary legacy point of view, or if you want to think it from a health point of view. Let us not forget that there are nuggets that are part of our culture that we need to preserve and maintain for the generations to come and for our own self. Right, we can't be leaving this to the dark kitchens and the aggregators to capture our culinary space completely, in my opinion, in my personal opinion, right? Again, not to insult anybody or to insult a particular agency as such, but in my opinion, we need to preserve that. We need it very much. So I told you that I started my journey as an aspiring astronomer, and I read this quote in Ayuka, where I did my master's, in a kitchen, very humbly put by this astrophysicist, that the discovery of a new dish confers more happiness on humanity than the discovery of a new star, and nothing like one astronomer. While I have not been able to discover new stars, I could not get into PhD in astrophysics. I got it in computational biology. So therefore, I could not discover new stars. But I believe serendipitously, however, I am on the path of discovering new dishes along with all of you. I can't be doing it alone. So thank you. Thanks a lot. We are all open for discussions, questions, free willingly. Yeah.
Can I ask you a question?
Shoot.
When Albert Einstein died, he took his brain and tried to study it. You planning to do something, you offer and like transfer directly onto the computer, because you got more recipe than what you have online.
I don't think so. I'm a very bad chef as of now. I'm learning. In fact, I'm trying.
Not your chef, it's the brain.
Brain. So not the brain. You need to take my hard disk. That's what. That's good enough. Because it's computational, you see. Yes, please. Yeah.
How are you coding for all these different flavors and such?
How am I coding for it?
Yeah.
So basically, recipes, they are encoded in a, right now the way data structure that I'm using is that of recipes into two parts, the ingredient section and the cooking instruction section, and each has been broken down into pieces of which is the technique which is being used, what is the ingredient quantity, etc. Coming to flavor molecules, you have ingredients, let's say tomato or chili for that matter, and what are the flavor molecules that are present in it. And when I say flavor molecule, we have its chemical identity using something called PubChem ID, Smile ID. So any agent, for example, the flavor industry recognizes flavor in a slightly different manner than a typical chemist recognizes it. So we have put all of them together, and chemical structure. So if you want to look at the chemical structure, three-dimensional structure also, if you want to look at it, it's all available. Incidentally, just to answer your question, this app is available on Play Store called FlavorDB. So it's an Android app as of now. Unfortunately, it's not on iPhone yet. I'm sorry for that, but FlavorDB is available on browser. Just search for FlavorDB, you will get it in browser. You can just browse it, and browser is in fact far more powerful than the Android app. Okay, so I mean that's a loose answer that I can give in terms of structuring. It's a database, MySQL database. If you want to ask me a specific question, it's a MySQL database which has been created to make, without which you can't investigate this data. Somebody had a question. Yeah.
Why don't you open a restaurant?
This question has been asked to me. I'm a bad chef and I can't even think of opening a restaurant where I can cook, but definitely I can think of opening a restaurant where I can have people cooking for myself. Well, I don't have any immediate, sorry, yeah? Well, they can be partners. You can happily see that. Yeah, quite clearly. I don't know if I can open my own restaurant, But long back, because of one of my distractor, I got a name for my restaurant, even whether I open it or not. I called it Blend It Like Babbler.
That is not what I'm saying.
You are overanalyzing the data.
Yes.
Taking away, you know, the human touch, the hermeneutical approach.
Correct.
For example, that we completely take away what is human,
mm-hmm.
and we say this flavor plus this flavor results in a better
yeah.
deal, and therefore this is the best way to do it. Mm. And, you know, I've taken 5,000 mango recipes, and this is the culmination of all 5,000.
Right.
This is best.
Right.
And then you feed it to people and they say, ugh.
I don't like it.
Yeah. And I want to add to
so
this.
So what happens then?
Sure. I take your point
can
and
I,
now
can
take
I add
no,
to
no,
this
please add it. Please.
You know, I was thinking of the same thing.
Yep.
You know, in Indian food, one of the difficulties for codifying recipes is andaz, the whole thing of andaz.
Hmm.
Also, when you have techniques like bunoing something, it's a matter of andaz when you stop.
Mm-hmm.
You know, how much do you caramelize that? That's a matter of instinct. So how does that work with your scientific...
I don't know. Let me quickly pull them together and you want to add those.
Like where we cook and on what we cook also plays a major role.
Fair enough. The additional factors also play a role. I take it. First of all, I resonate with it. I love music. I listen to music. I would hate creating a robot which will play like Sachin Tendulkar. Not really. Or I would hate a computer program which is recreating A.R. Rahman or Picasso. Not really. Right? There is some amount of intuition, human cognition, etc., whatever you name it, which is coming into the picture, which is getting marred is what the thought comes, right, when you think about it. My thought is this, is that let the human culture, civilization, intuition, let it flow. But why stop analyzing it in the first place? In fact, that reminds me of Richard Feynman's very famous quote. I don't know how many of you have known somebody called Richard Feynman. If you don't know, as a person, you should know him. One of the wonderful, loving persons, you must know him, right? If you want to understand physics at a child level also, right? Just go and understand what he's saying. He says that while I can understand the beauty of a flower, the evolution of a flower, the fragrance it is coming, the way it has evolved and the fragrance it has developed because it wants to attract the insect which will pollinate it and thereby letting it come through centuries, right, together. I can analyze it science also while I can appreciate its beauty. Can we do it together? Can we analyze it and while understanding and appreciating the beauty and not trying to create the best and all that? There is nothing called the best per se, right? When it comes to food, it is so personal that what is good for you may not be good for me. So I absolutely get your thought. But at the same time, I strongly believe that there is a huge scope for analyzing because nothing has been practically done. So we should do that while appreciating the human aspect of it. That's my thought about it. I hope I've captured you. I didn't capture your point. What is happening is that so far we have gathered only a couple of sensory elements, the taste and the olfactory part, right? No, not only where you are eating, what music you are listening, but whom you are eating can be a play, right? There are a lot of subjective matters coming to the picture.
Yes.
Of course. There was a question, right? Makes a huge difference. I completely get that. Unfortunately, if you try to aim to pick in every factor, then the science is way too complex. I'm like flawed. I just can't do anything about it. Therefore, we call it in physics the spherical cow model. What does that mean? We start with this assumption saying that let us assume that the cow is spherical. Everybody will say, come on, what is this, Ganesh? Nonsense, right? Yeah, I agree. But depends on what question you're asking. If you're trying to answer the question of how the cow moves, then spherical cow is a bad assumption. But if you want to find out how much is the heat emitted or generated by a cow, then it's a fairly good assumption because the surface area of a cow is approximately close to a sphere. Right? That's what we do. So right now we are working with spherical cow. We call it 16th century physics, let's call it, right? It will take time for us to come to that level, but people are trying to do that. Neurogastronomy, they call it, like measuring fMRI signals, EEG signals. Wonderful studies that are being done. Some of them are too reductionist. I don't like it, like you don't like it. But at the same time, I believe that some of them are going to give us fantastic understanding of how we perceive food and how probably we should change our way we eat our food. For example, can we eat the same food which is not so sugary, but still I feel the sugariness or the sweetness of it. Right? Can I do that so that I can steer away from myself from diabetes? Well, worth doing experiments, I would say. But thanks, yeah.
Can that lead us into measuring taste as well?
It has already led us into measuring taste. Taste is being measured heavily being measured, except that the measures are rather simplistic, as I say. They are rather uniform, and people are trying to make it like non-linear, etc. It's happening. It's under process.
He's nearing tears. Please answer his question.
Yes, please.
I want to know if this is similar to the work IBM is doing with Chef Watson.
I don't exactly know what Watson is doing, partly because they don't reveal the data.
Okay.
But yes, at a level where they were trying to create a Chef Watson,
yeah.
I would say that, try imagining this. They have not published anything barring a few esoteric papers here and there. You can look at it.
They've also done a couple of recipes.
I know. And even we have generated recipes, except that we have not cooked them yet. So this thought is there. It's been there. And science evolves like this, especially when you have a large community, science evolves like this. I happen to take up this theme, develop databases, develop algorithms, make them open, whereas a company like IBM would not want to do that. Right? And it's trying to close it down like that. So I really don't know inside what's happening. But some of the inside information that I also get through some other people say that kuch nahi ho raha hai. So I don't know. Kuch nahi ho raha hai. Unke paas kuch nahi ho raha hai. So I don't know.
I have a question. Is Indian cuisine a far more difficult cuisine to do in your computational world versus say French or American cuisine? Are they simpler cuisines?
I don't know how you define difficulty or ease of it, but I believe that once the recipe is encoded, standardized recipe or recipe otherwise is encoded, nothing is easy or difficult, but we can define not simplicity or difficulty, but complexity. Yeah, we are trying to define that. So there is a measure of complexity that we are coming towards, which can tell us which recipes are more complex versus the other ones. But we don't have a result over it yet, unfortunately. So I'm not the right person to tell about difficulty or simplicity of the recipes.
One other thing with the dehumanizing thing that sort of left you, I think one point that
you can
mentioned,
decide when to stop. Huh?
No, you give me.
So one point that you sort of mentioned, I think, particularly stood out for me was that sort of using this to augment the capability of say someone
sure.
like say Pratik, right?
Yeah.
So, which is already happening in say the game called Go, where AlphaGo is now being used by the top players
yep,
to improve
yep.
how
yep.
they have you know
yep.
their strategies
true,
of the
true,
game
true,
itself.
True.
And her thing about sort of that, like you know how you said that you are. Measuring you know, two particular characteristics of food to sort of identify how cuisine, etc. is. I remember reading your paper back in 2015 when it came out.
Really? I'm glad. Somebody has read my scientific paper.
And one of the reasons was that I was building a food recommendation engine to see what can be done beyond just sort of reading reviews and can we use like for example, because we're from India and everyone's perspective of what Indian cuisine is different itself. So for example, biryani itself is like always debated hugely. Can we introduce the aspect of texture? Can we again sort of what ingredients are being used?
Fine.
Someone asks for a recommendation for a biryani, can I use the person's background in terms of where the person is
and
then automatically
context.
Yeah, exactly, add context?
So what's the point? So you're saying that?
Well, right.
Uh-huh.
So I think those signals add to sort of what kind of recipes can be developed and including sort of textures and stuff like that.
Eminently. So when I said that it could be done that way, the Go example that you
right.
gave is almost close to that. Go is a very complex game and therefore a huge amount of human intelligence is involved there, intuition is involved there. It's like saying that Vishwanathan Anand replicating him or her, right? Anybody who's playing good at a particular game, chess or a Go for that matter. But can you help a chef doing analytics of all of these is what the game that I'm trying to play. Replacing a chef is not the game. And that's a bad game to play in my opinion. But at the end of the day, we should be cooking, we should be creating our own recipes. But at the same time, we can be enabled by something which has got a better memory, literally in terms of memory, as opposed to what we have and the computational capability. Yeah? Maybe we can have a couple of more questions. Yes. Yes, please.
Yeah. I think this data could be used by the food processing industry because they have limited number of products which they can make it for mass consumption.
Yeah.
I think that could be.
Yeah, yeah.
Or is it being done?
In a way, it is being done. So the patterns that we are generating, right now it is, as I said, it's for non-commercial purposes only. But some of the companies who have approached us, we have tried to give them culinary fingerprints of different cuisines and thereby trying to help them design products which are specific to a specific population which might help them. And we are testing them out. So it's under progress right now. I can't obviously name them, but it's under progress right now. Yeah.
Also, this could be used like, you know, I mean, most of the chefs I've read is like the flavor thesaurus
uh-huh.
or the flavor
yes.
matrix.
Yeah.
Where you can actually have different compounds and flavors and groups like alkaline, acidic,
right.
as per the pH value and the flavor and the heat, like spices, herbs, seeds, nuts, lentils, and maybe using the flavor profiles, you can create new recipes out of the
wonderful. That's idea
as well.
That the app actually allows you to do that. I mean, in a way, based on the present data, it allows you to do pairing. It tries to tell you which are the ingredients which are most common to each other.
So it's the art of creating something out of nothing.
Precisely.
You know,
precisely.
Something like that.
We are creating chart only, except that the chart is more like a web page rather than being a static
web page.
Let
us know when it's ready.
Of course. Yeah. And moreover, probably I would need inputs from you guys.
Anytime.
Yeah, I mean, that's required, without which I can't do it. Yeah?
Sure.
Great, yeah.
I think we should wrap up. He's going to be around after, unless you want to make it quick.
Will it also help us understand what we're eating more than how we're eating it in some way, like the traceability of all our ingredients?
Some of the ecology and sustainability related work that we are taking up, as of now we have not done anything of that sort. But the some of the work that we are doing in terms of blockchain and tracing ingredients might help us in that direction, very quickly. Yeah, I'm available, as Garima said, soon after this, so I can talk to you guys. Thank you. Thanks a lot.